good to be here.
I couldn't hear him. Turns out from back there, you can't hear anything. That's fun. Yeah, we're going to talk about CSS. You've maybe heard of it. It's the one core web language that's not part of the Jamstack acronym, unless maybe it's in there twice because it's just that cool. Yeah, let's just fix this quick. Yeah, there we go. That fits. We're going to actually start a little bit farther back, 1989, with the release of the first hypermedia browser, the WWW browser. And you can see it's designed for this fancy graphic interface on the next machine. But you can't make a web that's worldwide by saying it works on my machine and everyone else is an edge case. So right away, they released the second browser, the line mode browser, which is a text-only, keyboard-only, no graphic interface at all, developed by Nicola Pello. And this proves a point, but it also becomes the mission statement of the web organization, web for all, web on everything. And everything is a lot of things. It includes not only this old IBM terminal, but your latest 5K monitor, all these mobile devices, assistive technologies, smart watches, smart speakers. It's just on everything, the web everywhere, getting kind of sticky and gross. So we're designing unknown content on unknown with unknown collaborators on an infinite and unknowable canvas across operating systems, interfaces, writing modes, languages. It's absurd that we would even try to do style on the web. And the initial documents say that we won't be able to do it. But it all relies on this idea of normal flow, which is we can have a container that resizes its contents. And then, weirdly, we can have contents that resize their container. And somehow this is supposed to work, where the information is flowing both ways, both controlling the other one. We're going to fast forward a bit. CSS is proposed in 94, starts getting implemented around 2000. The initial proposal has media queries in it, but we don't actually get them until 2008. And Ethan Marcotte declares it the era of responsive web design. And we've had trouble getting out of this era. But it's sort of an evolution of the responsive web that already existed. And the rules of responsive design were like, OK, we're going to have fluid grids. And by grids, we mean floats. And by fluid, we mean we remove all of that intrinsic sizing information, and we replace it with percentages. And then we're going to use flexible images. And again, we remove all the intrinsic information about the size, about the aspect ratio, take all that out, replace it with percentages. And then we use media queries to tie it all together. And it's pretty cool. We can change the layout of our card as the window grows bigger. That's handy. But what if we put one of those cards in the wrong place? Then the size of the viewport doesn't accurately reflect the container that we want to be measuring to change our layout. That's not going to work. So right away, as soon as media queries landed, everybody was asking, can we have container queries? All the conversations around this start around the same time. Please, if we promise to be good, and the answer is just no. It is never going to happen. So a little like design on the web. And the reason it's never going to happen is because of normal flow. Because contents are sizing to the container, and containers are sizing to the content. Which one are you going to measure? Which one are you going to change? What happens if you change one and the other one changes? It's a loop. There's no way to do it. Jumping forward again to now, we've got flexbox and grid, box alignment, viewport units, actual explicit intrinsic sizing, aspect ratios, min, max, clamp. It is now the era of intrinsic web design, as coined by Jen Simmons. We're putting all this intrinsic information back into our designs, and that's super powerful. We've got truly two-dimensional layouts combining fixed and fluid elements of the same page, and then coordinating how they squish in different stages. Some they adapt and change at different times. We've got nested content that expands and contracts. And then media queries, no longer the center of it, but as needed. They're useful. But wait a second. If we've got nested contexts with content that expands and contracts, that sounds a whole lot to me like we've got containers that we wish we could query. And it turns out over the last 10 years, a lot of people have been laying the groundwork for this, the foundations. In 2020, David Barron proposed @container and Brian Cardell proposed @switch function, two different approaches to trying to get container queries into the browser. And the W3C, the CSS working group, picked @container as the one we wanted to pursue. And it relies on CSS containment, which is one of the new features that's been developed over the last 10 years. We've got size containment, layout containment, style, paint. These are different phases of the browser rendering process. We can sort of lock down the different phases and say, stuff that happens in this area shouldn't affect things outside, so you can be smart about how you're handling those relationships. And this helps us close the loop. We can say things inside this box shouldn't affect the size of the box or anything outside of it. But there's a little bit of a problem with size containment. It removes that intrinsic sizing again. So we can't do this. We have to turn that off if we want size containment to work. And we already know there's a little bit of a problem with what happens when you remove intrinsic sizing. Things honk right out of the box. And whoops, and it's even a little bit worse. Let's see, is it gonna go? There we go. If you add size containment, it gets worse. That's not gonna work for us. So ideally what we want is some sort of single axis size containment where we can say, okay, let's remove the intrinsic sizing on the width, we'll give that sizing using the grid, and then we still want the height to grow and shrink based on the content, so we have somewhere for that content to go. And this is, there's a lot of problems with that in CSS. There's definitely dragons, and I'm not gonna go into all of them, but Ian Kilpatrick, one of the Chrome developers, found a way through for inline size containment, not for block size containment. So we can contain both axes together, or we contain the inline axis, the axis that text flows in. For English speakers, that's generally width. But we can't contain block size on its own, at this point at least. And there's still a few gotchas there. Size containment means you're removing the intrinsic size on at least one dimension. Subgrids can't contribute back information to their grandparent. Counters are contained. There's a few little things there. But browsers were like, OK, yeah, this is something that we can ship. And so we went from it's impossible to it's shipping to it landed in two browser engines within 2 weeks earlier this fall. So let's look at how to use them. First, we need to define containers that we want to query, elements on the page that should be queryable. And instead of actually specifying all of the containments that you need, we can do better than that. So there's a container type, and we can say probably the most common one to use will be inline size, but you can also set size containment if you want to measure and explicitly size both axes. And normal is the default, which we'll see why in a bit. There is no default container on the page. So if you start adding container queries right away, there's nothing to query. So we need to go in and put in some containers first. And you can use the root element as a container. We didn't want to do that automatically for you because there's a few side effects with how things propagate to the viewport. But you can set this up. You have a default container as a fallback. And it would then work very much like media queries, except that if you're querying a relative unit like ems or rems, it's actually measuring ems and rems on the element, not some sort of ethereal browser em that is on the viewport that media queries are measuring. And we can set up as many containers as we need to, giving them whatever container types we want. And we can even give them names. And names can be sort of like IDs, like we're only going to use it once. The root, this is the root container, great. Or they can be more like classes, something we're going to reuse across various containers. We can say this is a layout container, and the root container, we can give it multiple names if we want. And we can set up various containers with different names. And like I said, like layouts repeated there, and we've got a component container. So whatever systems make sense for naming containers, totally optional. And there's a shorthand if we want to do both things at once. Names come first. Names are required in the shorthand. If you don't want to name your containers, don't use the shorthand. But names and then slash and then the type. Once we have containers, we can start to query them. So that's allowing elements to find out their context. And we can basically take the media queries that we've got and replace at media with at container, and it works. You're going to probably want to change the size there because you're measuring something different. But then each card, each H2, is going to look for its container and measure it, see if it matches the query. You can also use a range syntax. All the browsers are implementing range syntax along with container queries. So you can do, say, width greater than, or you can do greater than equal, or whatever you want. And then each element that's matched, and by matched, I mean we've got two selectors here inside of the query. Those are going to go match a bunch of elements on the page. Each element that is matched will find its nearest ancestor that has the necessary container type. So if you're measuring the width, it's going to go look and see, do we have a container that can tell us a width? And then it works. This is live code in the browser. This is shipped. We can also nest containers. A container can't query itself, so it queries the next one up. So you're always querying an element higher up, but you can nest them. Eric Portis made this 36 chambers demo, just checking out there. The borders are changing based on the size of the parent container. So that's containers querying containers forever, which is, I think, how we all plan to do it. I hope everybody's making websites exactly like that. When it matters, we can query named containers. We can say, OK, I want to query specifically the card container. And that just changes this algorithm a little bit. Each matched element queries the nearest ancestor with the necessary container type and name. Great. Jump up a few containers if we want to. So one of the first demos that came out, my colleague David Herron showed the same block quote in three different containers. Great. This is one by Una Kravitz, just showing a bunch of nested containers within a single card. So the button changed, the icon changed, the card changed, everything changes as it's resizing. Jay Tompkins goes a little over the top here with resizing and attaching individual keyframe containers. There we go. There's a little bit of a gotcha where, because everything is querying the next thing up and we're only querying elements, there's no real element that represents the track size in a grid or in a flex container, right? So the outer container is not the size of the track that's being created for the grid layout or the flex layout. So in those cases, say we've got a grid section and then card articles, we're going to need to do a little bit of turning components into turtles. They need to carry their container with them in these contexts so that we have something to measure. So you can wrap it in a container. That becomes the grid item. Now we have something to measure as the grid track. And then the card inside can query that and respond to it. So you can see that happening here. This is a flexbox layout. So that last one stays a different size. And because it's carrying its container with it, it's able to respond to that different sizing. Web components come with that sort of a component shell built in. We've got the host element. And while we're calling out Zach will tell you all about web components and the host element. Here's a demo by Max Buck showing these are all the same web component with different content put in. And then as you drag them around into the featured section or into the cart, they change their layout based on their context using container queries. We also get container query units. These are very similar to viewport units. So we've got viewport width, viewport height, viewport inline, viewport block, vmin, vmax. Now we get CQ versions of all of those, and they're measuring the container. These do come with a fallback. They fall back to what we call the small viewport, which is the viewport if all the browser Chrome is there. This is an important distinction. If you're on mobile, sometimes the Chrome goes away, sometimes it comes in. The small viewport is the smaller of those. So we can use this for things like responsive font sizing that's responsive not to the browser as a whole, but to specific containers. This demo by Scott Kellum shows sort of a product page, and you can see the font sizes staying relative to each individual box rather than growing with the overall viewport. Val Head made some demos on CodePen for how to use this in animations to say, I want to go from one side of the container to the other side of the container. So she's using CQ units here for animating the clouds across the page. And this has landed, like I said, in quite a few browsers, all the Chromium browsers and the WebKit browsers. And it's in active development in Firefox, expected to come soon, but there's no official word on that. It's just me watching that issue very closely and seems to be getting there. It is behind a flag in Firefox, but slowly adding functionality. If you need to do fallbacks, you can do that with the @supports. @supports not container name. It's a good way to do it. You can check container type. Any of the container properties there will work, and you can put fallback code in there. There's also a polyfill from Chrome Labs if that's more your style. And then we thought, well, okay, we had media queries, and we were able to query not just the size of the media, but user preferences and device interface capabilities, all sorts of things. What else would we want to ask a container? So the first one that we've already spec'd out and Chrome has a prototype of is style queries. And the idea is we could say, okay, what is the computed style on my container? Is the font style italic? If the container is italic already, maybe we want our M's to have a different styling on them. So we could do that. Or we could say, okay, let's have some higher level custom properties that we're querying to make bigger changes. So we say we've got this tooltip. We need to move that little arrow around to different places. We can just change one custom property, set where the arrow should go, and then use container queries to move that arrow around. Here's a button theme, a button with a button theme custom property. And if I set it to Mia, there, it becomes fancy, and if I set it to Mia Plus, it becomes even fancier, which is, again, what we do, make things pretty on the web. There's a prototype of that in Chromium as well, in the Canary. If you turn on experimental web platform features, it currently only works with custom properties. That's easier to build. It's possible that it will ship with just custom properties first and then standard properties later. That would mean we couldn't do the font style thing quite yet. But we're planning on the whole thing. And then we've got more things that we might want to query. Maybe states. Is something position sticky and currently stuck? Can we change the contents based on that is stuck state? Can we check to see whether something is scroll snapped and currently snapped? That would be useful, potentially. Basically, our medium is not done. Some things that we thought were impossible for 38 years are now shipping, and that will continue to happen. And the CSS Working Group is always interested in both feedback on these prototypes as they come out, on the specs as we're working on them, and also new ideas. So if you have ideas or are interested, start playing with stuff and give us feedback. Enjoy the jamming.